dirt on your knees and blood in your teeth. You want life to lead you to believe in something, but it's coming, all the numbing. You dive on into the deeper end for a blissful kiss from Judas' lips, but it's coming, oh yeah, the numbing. Supernova came, you're dead as dead can be. You won't feel a thing, sleepwalking. You're dead as dead can be. You won't feel a thing. Analyzed and diagnosed, overexposed to the undertow. You'll never know it's coming, all the numbing. So you meditate and medicate to maintain or to get away, but it's coming, oh yeah, the numbing. Supernova came, you're dead as dead can be. You won't feel a thing, sleepwalking. You're dead as dead can be. You won't feel a thing. Supernova came, you're dead as dead can be. You won't feel a thing, sleepwalking. You're dead as dead can be, living in a dream. Supernova came, you're dead as dead can be. You won't feel a thing, sleepwalking. Your dead as dead can be. You won't feel a thing.
That was fun.
Yeah.
Sounds great on acoustic as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, usually we have usually percussion. Change them too. You know, like we write something and it's heavy, and yeah. It rocks, and then yeah. You do it acoustically and you're like, what?
Yeah. Yeah. So you got to change it from, you know, the distortion and all the modulations yeah. You can put on the guitar when you're, you know, doing actual.
Exactly. Rock, you know? Yeah, exactly. So when you have full band behind you, it's one beast, and then this is completely yeah. Different, but it's fun yeah. For sure. Yeah. Want to jump into the next one?
Sure.
Okay.
You guys
want to
crack that out and then we'll...
yep.
Oh, sweet.
Change my attempt, good intentions. Crouch. Over, you were not there, living in fear, but signs were not really that scarce. Obvious tears, but I will not hide you through this. I want you to help, please see the bleeding heart perched on my shirt. Die, withdraw. Hiding cold sweat, quivering lips, ignore remorse. Naming a cat, living wasteland this time. You've tried all that you can, turning you red. Change my intentions. Should I? Could I? There we are with your obsessions. Should I? Could I? Crowned, hopeless, the article read, living wasteland this time. You've tried all that you can, turning you red, but I will not hide you through this. I want you to yell. Change my attempt, good intentions. Should I? Could I? There we are with your obsessions. Should I? Could I? Heave the silver, hollow sliver, passing through another victim. Turn and tremble, be judgmental, ignorant to all the symbols. Blind the face with beauty based. Eventually, you'll one day know. Change my attempt, good intentions. Limbs tied, skin tight, self-inflicted, his perdition. Should I, could I, change my attempt, good intentions? Should I, could
sound like Tara Reid.
Smokey Barlow.
We did just leave L.A.
Yeah. Smog lungs?
Yeah, exactly. Smog lung.
All right.
Hey. So this is what, second stop on your tour so far?
Oh, no. We started this thing up...
I think this is the 11th or 12th.
11th okay. or 12th Something show, like yeah.
I was looking, I was trying to look up the past dates, but for some reason Google wasn't popping it up on me.
Oh, yeah.
It's getting a little weird.
Yeah, so we've got another, like, 8 shows, I think, on this one. 8 or 9.
Well, guys, Jesse, Brian, thanks for coming in
and
chatting with us. You guys are going to be playing a headline show at Jub Jubs tonight, which, you know, it's been since 2015, since the last time you guys were here at the Knitting Factory, and definitely glad to have you back.
Thank you.
How's the tour been so far? As you just said, you've been out for, what, a little over 2 months now then, with about 11 dates?
No, a couple, 2 weeks.
2 weeks, 11 dates.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
It's strenuous.
You guys are doing a powerhouse tour.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
At least 5 shows a week, but it's been going really well. I mean, I think we've only had one that was the audience were just like crickets. And when that happens, you know, that's a lot of fun. But we've been having a lot of great reception from the crowds.
Mm-hmm. It's fun playing the new stuff because, you know, we've been playing a lot of the old material for so long, and you know, a lot of people know us from the song Wasteland, and now that Novocaine has actually really gotten some traction and stuff, we see like a new generation of fans starting to come out where they don't even really know some of the older songs, mm-hmm. even the singles, but they'll know Novocaine, and yeah. it's really cool. I feel like yeah, we're actually, it's what we're doing is working, because, you know, the goal is to always, you have your fans, and then you build on that, and you get new fans, and... I think the song is helping achieve that, finally.
Yeah, you guys made some sonic changes in this last album. Yep. It's definitely, it seems a lot more personal and intimate. Tell me a little bit about more of what you guys kind of put into the studio time in making How We Live as Ghost.
Well, it was tough because for us, we like to overthink everything. And and if we're left, you know, if we're in charge of making the records, we like, I mean, especially me as a producer, I like to approach things in a cinematic way. Mm-hmm. We're really inspired by movies and film and how the scores always accompany an emotion and they help drive an emotion. And so we're really big into layers and textures and lots of stuff going on. And we worked with the producer Nick Raskulinics on this one, who's, you know, I mean, everybody from Foo Fighters, Deftones, Alice in Chains work with this guy. And so we thought, you know, if those bands trust him, then we should let our guard down a little mm-hmm. and do the same. And day one, he was like, we're stripping all that stuff away and we're getting back to basics, drums, bass, guitar, mm-hmm. and minimal vocals. And it was like his whole idea from the beginning was to present us in a way that was just real and vulnerable. And, mm-hmm. and you know, with Jesse's voice, there's a certain special character in it and something that really, an emotion that translates to the listener, I think, when you don't have 10 layers of harmonies behind him and things like that. So Nick was very adamant about keeping things simple and more stripped down. Yeah. That's why it sounds intimate, you mm-hmm. know? Yeah.
I definitely, you can float your voice between falsetto and back yeah. and forth in your vocal flourishes. Like, really, it's... So, I mean, as somebody that sang for a long time growing yeah. up, that's an amazing talent. And you know, normally you hear somebody really have to force that falsetto yeah. out. And so to be able to just hear the light hints of those higher, you know, up a fifth octave notes that you throw in, man, it really almost makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up.
It was something I had to learn because hitting it full voice constantly is not sustainable sometimes. Mm-hmm. And then when you actually get a smooth transition with it, it does give a different mood. I mean, look at the king of it. It's like Tom York. Mm-hmm. And it does. It gives that sort of swimmy, ghostly vibe mm-hmm. that instead of just belting everything.
Exactly. Now, you guys got a pretty amazing tour. You're going to be out, Rock on the Range. You're going to be out Rock Fest. You're also going to be playing with, like, A Perfect Circle, STP, Nothing More a few times.
Yeah.
What's that like looking forward to? I mean, you guys have done big festivals, obviously, yeah, yeah. so you're prepared for it. But, I mean, what's it like, you know, as the music scene continues to change? 2018 is, you know, you can already feel a difference between, like, 2016, 2017.
Yeah, totally.
People listen to music and consume media. Everything is so different. How do you continue to, you know, keep yourself on those big bills?
It's very tricky. And I mean, I think that it really helps to network with a lot of, you know, from other bands to you guys letting us come into the station and stuff. And it's just getting the word out there and working hard and pounding the pavement. And it's great to be part of those things because there's an energy at those festivals that is, you can't compare it. I mean, they're all day long or all weekend long, it's just people there to celebrate it.
The one good thing, though, about even though the times are changing and people are, like you said, consuming music totally differently, now it's almost like album sales are becoming irrelevant, mm-hmm. you know? And it's about streams, and it's about social media, and it's about YouTube views and things like that. But the one constant is that people still want to see music live. Mm-hmm. And regardless of how they're, you know, digesting it in their own time, you have to bring a good live show. And so we've been road dogs since the beginning. Even, I mean, the band started in 1998.
Yeah, you're coming up on 2 decades now.
Yeah, I mean, it will be officially, well, it'll be 20 years since it started, 19 years since the first show. Mm-hmm. But that's the thing, though, is that no matter what's happening behind the scenes with how people are listening, they still want to see the live show. And even and now, more than ever, the live show's so important.
Very,
so
very.
you know, having Novocaine on the charts right now and people calling and requesting to hear it and driving that chart number does help us get on these big festivals. Mm-hmm. And man, you want to talk about, like, I mean, it's like literally like, you know, band camp when you go and there's a sea of tour buses, mm-hmm, backstage, and you get off the bus and it's like, oh, there's Maynard over there and there's, yeah, you know, whoever. Mm-hmm. It's pretty unreal. So it's exciting. Obviously, it's cool for the fans to have that many bands in one place, yeah, but for the bands too, we're all like geeking out, and mm-hmm, it's like, it's awesome.
That's how a lot of the, you know, cool collaborations come about, is when, yep, you know, you guys hang out in a green room and suddenly you're jamming something new that turns into a track later.
Yeah, I mean, it's it's cool to when you get a friendship that you don't expect. Like, we know the DeLeo brothers well.
Dean just texted me, Dean, yeah, from STP, and because we're one position higher than them, yeah, on the chart, mm-hmm, the rock chart, and he just texted me a screenshot of that and was like, bro, you're holding me down. You know, I mean, little kid Brian, who, yeah, had STP posters in my wall, right, in my room, would have never thought I'd be getting that message, but you become amazing. A community, you know?
But at the end of the day, we're all musicians, and I think once you're in it for a while, the freshman and sophomore phases can be a whirlwind, but after you've gotten past that, there's just a community of, mm-hmm, respect, I think, that stays there.
All right, one last question, because I know you guys got a lot to do today. Tell me a little bit about what went into Novocaine, because obviously with a name like Chronic, I'm into self-medication. Yeah. you know, what was kind of your thinking behind a song that's talking about kind of numbing yourself from dealing with things?
Well, wait, before you dive in, I have to say, oddly, because what happens is when we write these songs, musically, not trying to sound like, you know, it's so much easier to write the music than the vocals, but we can write the music in literally like four songs in a day if we're just firing, you know what I mean? Like, we can move super quick, but lyrically and vocally, it's always more time consuming because that's, you know, a lot of thought. Every word counts, yeah, and he especially really, yeah, drives himself nuts. So part of him driving himself nuts is sitting at a desk listening to our music demo of a song on repeat for however long it takes. And the idea for the numbing, mm-hmm, was the fact that he was sitting there literally like, I'm going numb listening to this damn song over and over.
And I related it to I feel like the repetition of life that we all experience and we can all relate to does desensitize you and numb you. And do you let that become your existence, or do you find things that make you feel alive, like going to a rock show or doing artwork or a sport or something? You have to break that repetition to feel alive. Mm-hmm. And the song itself, it comes off as sort of a negative thing. And my dad was like, you're always a protest guy. You're always, and I'm like, well, it's not that. It's just making people aware that we all feel this way. Mm-hmm. With the repetition of, especially as you get older and you're doing the same thing over and over, you got to stop and smell the roses. You know, you got to do what makes you appreciate life.
That's amazing. You know, because that's kind of the exact thing I felt coming through that album, is that, you know, you get into the grind of life and the responsibilities that come with adulthood and,
yeah,
being a parent and, you know, and things like that. And eventually you realize that there's all these dreams that you really never really got to kind, yep, of go after. So I don't know. Is that the midlife crisis that most, you know, of us are trying, yeah, to avoid?
I don't know if it's quarter or mid, or, you know, it depends on when it hits people. But I think that the pressure to succeed in especially this day and age with, mm-hmm, with everybody's social media, mine's bigger than yours, mine's better than yours, the, mm-hmm, look at me mentality. It's like, I think people get really lost and have an identity crisis. They don't know how to own their own individuality. Mm-hmm. They're chasing
likes this, and, yeah, mm-hmm, yeah.
So
I agree.
For me, I'm very old school in the sense, it's like, sometimes I've skateboarded for 20 years. I just got to hop on a skateboard and pause for the cause. Or, mm-hmm, with music, we can feel like it's the grind and my voice can be raspy. And on certain days I can feel like, I'm not in it today. And then we get on stage and that crowd is so into it that you go, this is why we do this. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, you know, watching people on the front row, like, cry to some of our songs, I'm like, man, that's just, that's wild to create something that means something that strongly to another person, you know,
yeah.
Especially in a different part of the world. Like, we played in Moscow, you know, had never been to Russia and had a sold out show and they sang every word. And I was like, this can't possibly be happening. Like, I was waiting for Candid Camera to come out, you know, but it was cool. I mean, we're definitely, we're very fortunate to do what we do.
Well, looking forward to seeing you guys tonight at Jub Jubs, and I can't wait to hopefully see you guys back on the West Coast, maybe Aftershock Festival, I'm hoping. That's kind of our crown of the West Coast, other than, you know, Knotfest, Ozfest. So
yeah.
I hope to see you guys at Ozfest.
We'd love to do it. We're going to be extremely busy on this album cycle.
That's awesome. So. Well, I'm going to sneak out of the house for a little bit and come down to Jub Jubs and see you guys. 10 years.
Awesome.
Jesse, Brian, thank you guys for taking some time to stop by.
Thanks man.